Betamax versus VHS and Blu-ray versus HD DVD. The home entertainment industry loves itself a good format war, and we are in the middle of a big one. HDR is the new thing in movies and TV, and it brings not one, not two, but depending on how you want to count them, somewhere between three and five competing standards. On the heels of our home entertainment guide, we're going to break down HDR, what it is, what do those standards mean, and what to know before you buy your next TV. Welcome to Upscaled, our show where we try to explain how your favorite tech works. We took a little break there to cover IFA and the new iPhones, and definitely go check out those videos if you want to see me nerd out about Asus's bonkers Pro Art laptop or some video of a seriously cute puppy. But now we are back. So today I want to talk about HDR, or High Dynamic Range Video. With 4K now standard for new TVs, HDR is the new visual technology that TV makers are pushing. Essentially, HDR lets your TV display a more vivid, lifelike image, and I personally feel like it's a bigger deal than 4K was if you want the best looking movies and TV. But HDR itself isn't just one thing. All of the different types of HDR out there are based on four main concepts: luminance, dynamic range, color space, and bit depth. Let's break it down. Luminance is a measure of how much light something emits, measured in candelas per square meter. A candela, incidentally, is a standard measure that roughly equates to the light emitted by a candle weighing 1/6 of a pound and being made of whale oil. The term nits means the exact same thing, and that's what I'm gonna use here. This is essentially how bright your screen can get, and in an office setting, a well-calibrated LCD monitor should be about 120 nits, and laptops can usually go as high as 300 or 500 to help with bright sun. CRT TVs back in the day were around 100 nits, and incidentally, 100 nits is also what standard dynamic range video was calibrated to. On a capable TV, HDR content can be much, much brighter. Manufacturers usually refer to this as the peak brightness, and one note, TVs can usually only sustain this peak brightness over a small part of the screen and for a brief period of time. In HDR video, things like reflections, headlights in the dark, laser blasts, and whatnot should all look, well, startlingly bright. A TV like the OLED LG C9 can top 800, and some LCD TVs like Samsung's Q9F put out over 1700 nits. So HDR TVs can get way brighter, especially when playing HDR content. But how exactly that brightness is used brings us to the second part of high dynamic range, the dynamic range. This is basically contrast, or the difference between the brightest and darkest parts of a scene. Dynamic range is typically measured in stops, which is a term brought over from cameras. Each stop is twice as bright as the one before it. These days, a lot of camera companies brag about their new cameras being able to deliver 14 or 15 stops of dynamic range, so it may surprise you to learn that standard dynamic range content, which is still the vast majority of what we see, tops out at about 6 stops. Manufacturers frequently report this in terms of contrast ratio, 5,000 to 1, 10,000 to 1, which is how much brighter the white a TV can display is than black. But now with OLED screens that can produce a true super dark black, some TV makers are just claiming infinite contrast, which isn't very meaningful. Either way though, more stops or a bigger ratio means you can have more contrast and more subtle detail, especially in the shadows and highlights. Dynamic range is partly dependent on the TV's contrast ratio, but at least one standard insists that a TV has to be capable of 13 stops of peak dynamic range to be considered HDR ready, though to be honest, most are closer to 10. Next, we've got color space, or gamut. This is the range of colors a TV can produce. Most SDR video and digital content in general, most JPEGs, most media on the web, all use a color space called Rec. 709 or sRGB. To simplify a bit, color space defines the maximum saturation for the primary colors, red, blue, and green, that a device can produce. The big HDR video standards all support a wider gamut, up to one called Rec. 2020, though a lot of the content actually uses the slightly less wide standard called PCI P3, which has actually been the standard for Apple's displays for a few years now. The difference between a normal and wide color gamut is kind of equivalent to luminance, but for color. Instead of brighter highlights, for example, an HDR screen should be able to show a more green green, a color that has a more pure hue and higher saturation. Side note, these RECs are standards developed by the ITU, or International Telecommunication Union, which is actually a branch of the United Nations. There are more than a dozen RECs, also sometimes prefixed with ITU or BT, which are recommendations that manufacturers try to follow to make sure their content renders properly on their screens. They are just recommendations, though, and there are still displays out there that can't even show 100% of the colors in Rec. 709, and even $45,000 reference monitors can't actually display all of Rec. 2020 yet. But the company used the standards as guides when calibrating their screens. The last feature of HDR is bit depth. This is the amount of data used to describe the brightness and color. With the exception of some professional video, SDR content was all 8-bit. The easiest way to think about this is with RGB color, where each pixel gets a value for red, green, and blue. In an 8-bit signal, you have 256 possible values for each color, which is 2 to the power of 8. 8-bit. So 000 would be black, while 255, 255, 255 is white, and 00255 would be pure blue, etc. Now, because of some weird physics, they actually gave the signal some headroom, so it was more like 16 to 235, but still. HDR uses 10 bits of data for each channel, expanding the possible range of values out to 2 to the 10th, or roughly 0 to 1023. They also transmit some metadata and do provide a little headroom again, so it's more like 60 to 940, but either way, you're looking at around 4 times the data being used to describe each pixel on your screen. The big advantage here is more subtle gradients, with less banding, and providing all the data needed for those super bright highlights. So what about the HDR standards themselves? Hybrid log gamma, or HLG, is kind of its own thing, but HDR10, 10 Plus, and Dolby Vision are all based on something called PQ, or the perceptual quantizer. And I am terribly sorry, but to explain this, we're gonna have to talk about the gamma curve. When a digital camera records an image, photons hit the sensor and get turned into voltage, and the camera records that voltage. Twice the voltage, and the pixel will be twice as bright. This is called a linear response, and it's how digital images are stored. If we imagine an 8-bit image, let's say 4 bits is the darkest signal the camera can register, so twice as bright as that to medium gray is 8 bits, double that to 16, then 32, 64, 128, and that doubles to 252, which is essentially all the data we can record, and that's our white point. But there's a problem here. At the very bottom of the scale, we only have 4 bits to show the difference in gradient between black and gray, while we've got 128 bits to show the difference between white and nearly white in the highlights. Linear encoding spends most of its data on the lightest few shades in an image and almost none on the shadows. And unfortunately, this is exactly the opposite of how our eyes work. We are extremely sensitive to changes in the lower end of our vision, but above a certain brightness point, we barely perceive any difference. A gamma curve, at its simplest, is an equation that bends that linear response and tries to bring it closer to how we actually see. It takes data away from the bright end of the spectrum and moves it into the darker end of the spectrum, where we actually see the most detail. Cameras these days frequently use a curve to help them spend more data to capture shadows when you actually take an image, and then your computer uses the opposite curve to make sure it displays correctly. The perceptual quantizer is like a gamma curve on steroids. It was designed primarily by Dolby, and it's based on how people actually perceive contrast at various luminance levels. It's supposed to be a closer analog to how your eyes actually work, and it comes with way more complicated math. At 10 bits, PQ uses twice the data of all of SDR, over 500 bits, to describe just 0 to 100 nits in brightness, but then it keeps going, with headroom built in to extend all the way to 10,000 nits of brightness. So what are the differences between these three standards based on PQ? Well, HDR10 is an open standard, which has made it the most popular form of HDR. If a TV says it supports HDR, you can bet it at least means HDR10. The downside is it's not rigidly defined. It's more a collection of suggested technology than a true standard. So the quality of HDR10 devices and content can vary widely. Still, at a minimum, HDR10 should include 10-bit video, a wide color gamut, and it generally targets a peak brightness of 1,000 nits. Dolby Vision, by contrast, is completely controlled by Dolby. It supports up to 12-bit video, though even if a TV can accept a 12-bit signal, a lot of content and the actual displays in pretty much every television are still only 10-bit. And it's usually mastered to a peak brightness of 4,000 nits. So Dolby Vision is potentially brighter than HDR10. But beyond that, if a company wants to support Dolby Vision on their device, they do have to pay a license fee, but in return, Dolby will work with them to make sure their TVs or monitors will properly and accurately render and playback Dolby Vision content. This does lead to one of the quirks of PQ. Gamma curves were relative. They modified the brightness of an image, but they had no innate values attached to them. PQ is an absolute. Every value between 0 and 1023 returns a specific brightness, no matter the TV. So an input of 519 bits should always display a brightness of 100, no matter where you're showing it. But this leads to a big problem. Remember, Dolby Vision is mastered to 4,000 nits, and no consumer TV can come close to that. Heck, plenty of them can barely reach the 1,000 nits of HDR10. So how do you solve this? Metadata. HDR10 video carries metadata that describes the average scene brightness and the maximum pixel brightness in whatever movie or show you're watching. TV makers then include algorithms that try to map that maximum brightness onto the brightest shade your TV can actually produce. It's essentially a gamma curve on top of the PQ curve. The downside here is that if you can imagine a generally dark show that has one really bright flash in one scene, the TV has to account for that single bright light, and it may shift the rest of the content darker to compensate. To try to fix this, Dolby Vision adds dynamic metadata, which shifts scene by scene or even shot by shot instead of being set for the entire program. Similarly, HDR10 Plus is an attempt to add dynamic metadata to the HDR10 standard. Because PQ is absolute, the idea is that when watching content from one of these three standards, and especially Dolby Vision, it should look the same in your living room as it did to the show's creators when they were editing it. This is great in theory, but one downside is it doesn't actually take into account how bright your room with your TV is. And by default, Dolby Vision is intended to be watched nearly in the dark. Originally, it seems Dolby wanted the PQ curve to actually override your TV's brightness settings when playing back Dolby Vision video, so it perfectly matched the director's vision. But it doesn't look like any TV manufacturers decided to actually do that. Though some, like Sony, may push your settings closer to what the director intended, i.e. much darker. The downside of each of these standards is they generally look washed out and gray on older non-HDR TVs. Streaming services can usually identify what your device supports and serve up an SDR version as needed, but that's not possible in broadcast. Enter HLG. HLG is our last HDR standard, and it was cooked up by the UK's BBC and Japan's NHK television networks to deliver HDR content via broadcast. HLG supports a wide color gamut and 10-bit video, but otherwise it's pretty different from the other standards. HLG stands for Hybrid Log Gamma, and that's essentially what it is. HLG takes the standard gamma curve that's been used in broadcast for nearly a century, but towards the brighter end, it smoothly transitions into a logarithmic curve that compresses the highlights and allows for much greater dynamic range. The idea here is that older TVs will just interpret the part of the picture where the standard gamma curve is, and the highlights that would clip to white in normal standard dynamic range content will look the same. But in TVs that support HLG, they'll get more detail in the brightest parts of the image. The end result isn't always perfect. On standard TVs, an HLG image can come through a little muted compared to true SDR content, but it's an easy way for broadcasters to start to transition into HDR broadcasts. So there you have it, the various standards and how they work. There are a few others floating around out there, but for now, HDR10, Dolby Vision, and HLG are the ones to watch. If a TV says it's HDR ready, it almost certainly supports HDR10 and probably HLG, but Dolby Vision and HDR10 Plus are more of an either-or situation, at least for now. In terms of providers, Amazon says most of their HDR10 content is also available in 10 Plus and has some shows in Dolby Vision. While Netflix has pretty much skipped HDR10 Plus, it has a lot of Dolby Vision and HDR10 on offer. Blu-ray is a mix, with some studios just opting to include every format on the same disc, so check before you buy. And sadly, Hulu has no HDR content for the moment. So, what do you think? Has HDR been a reason for you folks to upgrade? Or have there been any shows or movies in HDR that have blown you away? Let us know in the comments, and be sure to subscribe.